Dear Colibri students, welcome to the Advanced in Broadband Technologies module, module 11. Welcome to this second pill on fiber to the home. In previous pill, we were talking about market and economics, and in this case, we will talk about technologies and architectures. Okay, we were seeing in previous pill how this technology, fiber to the home, is being deployed and the market is growing. Now let's talk about the different industrial standards regulating this technology, like it will be the GPONs and the WDM PONs, and the expected evolution. First, let's have an overview of the different architectures. On the one hand, we can have what it is said, a home run architecture, or also set single star or point-to-point network. In this case, what you are providing is a fiber connection between your central office and each of the users that you want to provide the service. Which is the disadvantage? If you have 1,000 users, you need to provide 1,000 fibers. The main problem is not just only economic, because you need so many fibers, but also it is a question of how do you manage to connect and to deal with 1,000 fibers or scale with the number of users. Alternatively, it was proposed the active star architecture, which is based in an active node that it is just connected through a single fiber, and from there you are connected all the fibers. The disadvantage of this is that this active node requires power supply, specific conditions, because of the electronics involved in this. Finally, was proposed what it is said the passive optical network, or PON, where the active node is substituted by an optical power splitter or combiner, a very simple device, which is very cheap, it is passive, and then you can place wherever you want, and this is the miracle, economic miracle, of this kind of network. Let's have a view a little bit more in detail about how this device is implemented. This passive splitter, it's able for all the optical signals coming into the input port to be divided into two outputs that could have different ratio of output, but for example, in this case, let's consider it is just 50% for each of the outputs, half of the signal to each of them. In the same way that you are dividing the signal in a factor 1 to 2, you could also divide to 1 by n by simply, for example, cascading this kind of 1 by 2 splitters. If your device is nearly ideal, you could have an insertion loss of 3 dBs each time the signal is going through one of these splitters, in cases of 50% radio division. Of course, for commercial devices that they have also the imperfections of fabrication, these losses will be a little bit higher because there is a small quantity of signal that it is just lost in the process of division and is not obtained at the output of the device. For those of you coming from engineering schools, I'm giving here just a list of the precise definition and formulas of each of the parameters defining this kind of device, as they are the insertion losses, the excess loss, which is these extra losses not due to the division of the signal, the division splitting ratio, which percentage of signal you are giving to each of the outputs, and also the directivity, which is also a measurement of how good the device is fabricated. With all this, in 1995, a group of 7 international network operators decided to join and start to provide a definition of a first standard for this kind of fiber-based optical access. And in fact, 3 years later, in 1998, they provide the first international standard, which it was set broadband optical access system based in passive optical networks. It was set BPON, and it was started to be deployed in Asia, mainly in Japan and Korea, and in some countries in Europe. In fact, in 1999, the Electrical and Electronic Engineering Institute decided to join also to provide an alternative standard. Based on what? Based on the Ethernet. And in fact, they were calling this EPON, Ethernet PON, mainly because they were considering that there was a lot of work already deployed for Ethernet and they could reutilize this kind of the technology for Ethernet for also for the optical access. In fact, due to this, it started to be a relatively important competition between the two standards, the FSAN standard and the Ethernet PON. And in fact, it was just from the very beginning that the FSAN realized that it was required to update and improve the first standard. Due to this, and also due to the fact that the United States Competence Commission removed the unbundling requirements, that means that it was a measure for incentivizing the deployment of passive optical networks, many companies decided to be starting working in this technology. In fact, the ITT published a next recommendation, which was the gigabit PON, focused on transmitting 1 gigabit per second, and it was closely followed by the EEE that quickly published an alternative version also for 1 gigabit per second based in Ethernet, which was at the EPON that we were mentioning before. Finally, there was some discussions about different technology that should be combining with it, like the video franchising in PON. And in fact, in the next year, it has been an enormous effort in updating those standards. For example, recently, in 2009 and 2010, new standard has been published by the FSAN, for example, providing, by the EEE, providing a 10 gigabits per second update of the previous Ethernet passive optical network, and by the International Telecommunication Union in 2010, also an update to 10 gigabits per second of the previous GPON, in this case called XGPON. How this looks like, because this is a lot of names and different acronyms. At the end, what we are talking is that as an operator, what I need is a play so that I can multiplex different services. For example, customers will want to have internet, will have to have typical previous telephone services, and they will want also to have different kind of television channels and video services. At the end, what I'm going to do is to transmit all these services through an optical fiber to the home of the different users. As you can see, you can get more information about this in this fiber to the home technology book. Here it is described also how, from the technological point of view, is this analyzed. What you get is that we have to transmit different kind of services. On the one hand, we need to transmit the data from the user to the central office. This is what we said usually upstream. And also, they can be both voice and data. For this, it was assigned this wavelength at 1310 nanometers. Also, we need to transmit information from the central office to the users. For this, it was reserved another wavelength at 1490, which is also for the voice and data, what do we say, downstream, because it's transmission from the central office to the user. And also, in the downstream domain, we want also to transmit the video services and television services. For this, it was also reserved the 1550 nanometers. It should be mentioned that while those were digital transmissions, originally this video overlay was an analog service, though nowadays it's been evolving into a digital one. With all together, we know all the publication of the standards, we know also how the different wavelengths are assigned, but we need to know also how the fiber has to be installed. This slide is showing you that as an operator, you can have different kind of networks, also compatible with the different standards. You can have networks with class A, B, C, showing different link attenuation. That means that the losses from the central office to the users has to be in the range between 5 and 20 dB, or between 10 and 25, or between 15 and 30 dB. Why is this important? That means that also for the electronics, this is challenging, because that means that you can have at the central office signals coming from users with 15 dB more signal than other users, and electronics and your equipment has to be dealing with it. Just to finalize the requirements of the standards, we are showing here the different data rates that you can achieve, for example, with the first version of the GPON, EPON, and EPON standards. So, but how the networks looks like? You can see here how we could be having different topologies. You could have a tree topology, a bus topology, a ring topology, and it could be a very nice exercise for you to decide how you should be designing these power splitters, the distances here to different users, so that with these different topologies, you could have different class networks as we were seeing in previous slide. But at the end, which is the principle of operation of the passive optical network? We commented that we have downstream transmission from the central office to the user, and in this case, it's relatively simple to design. What we are having is transmitted in broadcast, so that the central office is transmitted to all the users, all the information, and depending on the logical link identifier is what the equipment for the final user is going to filter and to select just those packets of information that are for specific users. Yep. The most complex part is the upstream operation. Why? Because in this case, each user is going to be transmitting its information, yeah, but you can see here that the power splitter is just going to aggregate all this traffic, and what happens is that here, if in this figure all the users are transmitted at the right time, they could be synchronized so that here in the common fiber for all of them, all the packets are coming one after the other without any kind of collisions. But it is very difficult for them to do this. Why? Because different users do not see each other. It is very tricky here. We're not going to go too much into details of this on how the optical, the central office has to manage the transmission of all the users in order to avoid this kind of collision. In fact, just to give a few explanation about this, let's say that there are not kind of contention-based media access mechanism, as it was, for example, in first versions of Ethernet networks. And in this case, the only solution has to be that the OLT has to be able to synchronize the different optical network users and to exactly synchronize the clock of all of them and to grant different time slots for any of the users so that they can be transmitting only at the time that they are scheduled by the central office. This is, as it has been working till now, the fiber to the home networks with all the technology behind, optical, electrical, and protocols and management systems. What it is expected to be the future? Here, Huawei company is already predicting that nowadays we are working with about 2.5 gigabits per second, also downstream up to 10 gigabits per second by the current standards from 2009 and 2009. But it is expected that for 2015-16, we're going to be needing what it is said, the next generation 0.2, where probably we are looking for about 40 gigabits per second or WDM. What's this expected for? The reason is that market analysis is predicting that though nowadays users are going to be requiring something like about 20 megabits per second, due to the new applications, it is expected that about these years, users are starting to be needing 100 megabits per second. So that means that the network has to provide much more bandwidth. How to do this? Several proposals have been discussed and investigated during this year. For example, in this case, in the summary, Huawei is proposing like it could be used WDM PONs. That means that its network, in this case, its user is having its own wavelength for the transmission of the signal, its own, let's say, optical channel. And they were also foreseen how using the same cables, the same fiber infrastructure in the field, you can be providing this kind of much more broadband network. In fact, there is also a trend which is how the operators could be collecting the previous central offices into a much more simpler device and then collecting, aggregating all the previous central offices, providing service to all these networks in a single one in a much more remote location. This is also what has been proposed by Huawei, and finally, what has been done in research in last years. In last years, there has been several initiatives on research on WDM PON. Just as a summary, we can report the PMAN project, which is ultra-high capacity e-bit wavelength division multiplexing 10 division multiplex access. And in this case, it was proposed to have about 32 wavelengths in WDM system with in-the-field optical amplifiers based in erbium dot fiber amplifiers, and in this case providing up to 10 gigabits per second over 100 kilometers and connecting up to 512 optical network units per wavelength. The main challenge in this project also was the developing of the electronics also for the transmitters and receivers. And as a second report, we could be commenting the Sardana project, single fiber advanced ring dense access network architecture, which was in this case providing access also to 1,000 users using two fibers and providing a minimum granted of 100 megabits per second and a maximum of 10 gigabits per second per user over distances of 100 kilometers by single fiber and a fully passive plan. That means that even having optical amplification but without any kind of electronics in the fields. With this, we are summarizing the different technologies that have been used and what is expected in the next year. I hope it was interesting for you. Let's see us in the next PIL in this course. Thank you.